Another extremely important quantity in acoustics that we are going to use throughout the course is intensity. Let's first think in the time domain. Intensity, instantaneous intensity, or the intensity signal, is the product of the pressure signal times the velocity signal. So it is a vector quantity, it has a certain, or it is calculated in a certain direction. Think in terms of units. Pressure is force per unit area. Velocity is distance over time. So that force times distance is work, or is energy, and if you divide it by time, you get a power. So that intensity is measured in terms of power per unit area, or watt per square meter. That already gives you an idea that this is measuring the amount of power that is propagated by the acoustic source at a certain point in a given direction. Now, if you look at the intensity signal that we usually call the instantaneous intensity, because it is the product of two signals, if I calculate the spectrum of intensity, I see that it is the convolution product of the pressure spectrum and the velocity spectrum. You remember that if a signal in the time domain is the product of two signals, in the frequency domain, the simple product becomes a convolution product. So we have a spectrum I omega, which is the convolution product of P omega times V omega. In most cases, the component of intensity that have a non-zero frequency or pulsation are not very relevant. They are called the reactive intensity. It is not interesting because it represents a quantity that is propagating back and forth, and that has a zero mean over a time period. While the component that corresponds to omega equal to zero corresponds to a power that is constantly flowing and that has a non-zero mean over a time period. The component with a non-zero mean is called the active intensity, and the part with the zero mean is called the reactive intensity. I've presented here a sort of general definition based on the convolution product. But it is so important that I'd like to step back and look at a more simple example where I simply have a single frequency, a monochromatic signal at a pulsation omega. So the pressure signal is a certain amplitude times cosine omega t plus a phase. And the velocity, of course, occurs at the same frequency, the same pulsation, but has a different amplitude and a different phase. If I take the product of these two signals and rearrange the terms using the Simpson formulas, I see that the intensity contains, exactly like before, two components. One component that is constant and represents the active intensity, which means a constant flow of power from the source to a receiver, while the second term has a pulsation, in this case, of 2 omega t and a zero mean. Let's look at some practical case. Let's look at a general case first, where there's no specific phase relationship between the pressure and the velocity. You see that you have on this graph the pressure signal, the velocity signal, and the intensity signal, and you clearly see indeed that pressure and velocity have zero mean over a period, but that the intensity have a non-zero mean plus a fluctuating term. The constant term is the active intensity, the fluctuating term is the reactive intensity. Now let's look at two signals that are in phase. So the phase for the pressure and the phase for the velocity are identical. And there you see that the active intensity is maximum and the intensity is always positive, even if you take into account the fluctuating reactive components. This is called a purely propagating field. If you have a purely propagating wave, you will have a maximum intensity. And the last case that we are going to see is when the pressure and the velocity signal have a phase difference of 90 degrees. So they are in phase quadrature. And in this case, you see that the active intensity is equal to zero and that the reactive intensity fluctuates around that zero value. This is a characteristic of standing waves. There is no net flow of power from the source to the receiver. Whatever flows in one direction also flows in the other direction, and we'll see applications of that later on. To finish about intensity, let's see how we can measure that. Intensity is the product of pressure times velocity, and so we need to know the pressure. The pressure is just measured by a microphone, and in this case it will be measured by two microphones located very close to one another, and we'll say that the pressure measured by this device is the average value of the two pressure signals. What about the velocity? The velocity can be measured because we know that the velocity is proportional to the pressure gradient. And so this device, the two microphones, is going to give us something proportional to the velocity just by taking the difference between the two microphones divided by the distance between the two microphones. If you combine that, you get an intensity probe which can be used to directly measure intensity, and because intensity is a vector quantity, we are going to have a device that we can orient in space to measure intensity in the direction that we chose.